Yes, go ahead. You want to mind your way?
Okay, Joel, we should start, and so could people from the back either come in or do something else? So we're going to start. And yeah, okay, we're starting, you have to start. Yeah, don't do that.
Oh, I'm sorry. She said it was cute. There you go.
One of the ways in which one learns to lie when you work here is that you often find yourself at the podium saying, it's a great pleasure to welcome. And there are two things. One, you don't much like the look of the person. And secondly, you can't remember their name, so you're scrabbling through the events list. Professor of Architectural History at, who's recently published. It's not like that this evening. It's such a great pleasure to welcome both Jeff and Bob that I don't even mind if it isn't a pleasure for you. I mean, I fully intend to enjoy it. But actually, I know it's a pleasure for you that they're here. Both of them have a detailed kind of historical relation to the AA, and this is one way of demonstrating that it's our deepest hope that those relations will be renewed and continue. And so we thought, you know, that who better than Jeff and Bob to kind of, I'm not quite sure what the idea was, comment on your experience of Monday. Here's Monday. And it's completely silent because the volume's not on. But even when the volume was on, it was kind of a bit like that. I mean, it was strange to see two such eminent architects arrive as if they were sort of auditioning for the lead parts in kind of Waiting for Godot. In respect to that task, I think they did pretty well. Although,
who is that?
Even Beckett didn't have a character played by an architect born in Iraq, who was to sit in the front row of the audience growling, I don't think this is going anywhere. And spending the rest of the time quite sensibly doing her nails, rather ostentatiously. So I got a kind of feeling that to make a kind of bridge towards the, from the stubborn silence to the unstoppably articulate, we need a sort of brief bridge. So I've proposed something in the kind of nature of a very brief game. I'm going to ask each of them, before they start on the meat, the reality of the evening, to spend about 2 or 3 minutes each mimicking, first of all, what they would have wished that Peter had said and that Rem had said, and then Jeff will do it too. And then we can say goodbye to the sort of age of silent architecture and get on with the evening. So, Joel, perhaps we could now abandon these ghosts.
Look at Peter's makeup is incredible, though.
Okay.
And so,
all right.
We welcome both of you. And if you could start off by briefly mimicking both Peter Eisenman and Rem. Want to go first? You want to go first?
You want me to go first?
Yeah. Well, you've theorized architectural ventriloquism, so you
should
go first.
I have to start off by first saying that I think of the two practices as critical practices, and that the discussion will be grounded in that, and that I see them engaged in that way, and that partly I think the reason they have difficulties discussing is how they've chose the operations to be, the manner to be critical. So I imagine Rem, who I understand the work came out of discovering that form was not ideologically loaded, that form was an available tool, but it was not going to be the ideological focus of the possibility of an ideological architecture. And that freedom, there was a point at the time in the AA under the influences of Cedric Price, I've now learned this from Bob Somol, where a certain political project was demanded of architecture, but no one knew a vocabulary to work at it in. And so the insight that the modernist vocabulary was not already irrecoverably loaded with its formal ideologies, and that in fact it could be employed and redeployed, meant that you could do a critical architecture with an ideological focus without the formal, without engaging the intricacies of formal discussions. Whereas Peter is entirely invested in the specificities of the canons of formal argumentation and the degree to which any critical practice is going to only operate for the field at that level. And so one is entirely devoted to the ideologies of form, and one is entirely devoted to the possibilities of discussing ideology through form without any relationship to it whatsoever. Which means that they share precisely the same goal and debate on the techniques to achieve that goal. And I think what I wish they would have said is, you know, Peter would have asked Rem, why do you think making pretense arguments about changing the program and programmatic loading in 24-hour day does a damn thing to anything, to anybody, since everyday buildings already do that anyway? I don't need you to tell me to put a lot of program in a building when I can go to a shopping mall and there's already a lot of program in a building. So I know you're doing something else. Why don't you tell the truth? And then I think what Rem would have said to Peter is, why do you think confessing your difficult problems in process such that everyone becomes burdened with understanding what looking at your work for what you did matters to anybody at any political level whatsoever? And that's what I think would have been...
Well, that would have made it shorter. Bob.
Let's see, the preamble first. I think what's interesting is, maybe this is to parallel Jeff, which is what they have in common is at least as interesting as what they don't. I mean, the first point, the obvious points of what they don't have in common, obviously they're sort of a formation which is generationally, geographically, institutionally distinct. And in the past, I have made much out of the fact that one, Peter, represents a sort of the project of semiotic critique, and that the Koolhaas and others, as a different generational problem, represents the issue of institutional projection. I have stand by, to some extent, the differentiation between a critical project and a projective one, and I think that that still manifests itself in the work, and so maybe one point of discussion will be, what do we mean by critical, which I think is the first question raised, and which Jeff is responding to. But I think that that's also a bit too fast and stylized. I mean, I think the interesting thing is the way in which Rem now seems to be appreciated precisely for his forms, and I thought one of the more interesting comments of Rem was, well, Peter, how do you account for all of your institution building? In other words, there's a way in which Peter is a political actor in the sense that he has established institutions, schools, magazines, programs, groups. He's been nothing but a kind of producer of audience and institutions in a certain way. And so really has projected a different space for architecture to take place in. At least that's what I think Rem's compliment was really a way to say, you're really on my side. But I guess what I imagined, I'm not sure what I wanted them to say. I guess what I think Peter really wanted to say to Rem, because he said it to me as if I'm supposed to answer for Rem. Usually these happen in academic context. He says, let me ask you something, Bob. Time out. One question. How do you teach green dots? And I think that's really what Peter wants to know. You know, I'm a teacher and a pedagogue, and I want to know why, Rem, you think you can teach and how you would actually instruct somebody to do green dots, because in fact, I think teaching is a process-oriented field, and I've got a process. But I don't know what the discipline of your work is, which means I don't know how to reiterate it through teaching pedagogy. What Peter really said is that, since that wasn't what he asked, was bluntly he said, didn't you really steal my Berlin Tower 15 years later with CCTV? I guess what I wanted Rem to say is, yeah, I did. and a lot of other stuff, too.
Well, it never happened, and they left, and, you know, they made autism.
But everybody heard that.
What? They made autism seem like a great social skill. But now we come to the difficult bit, which is if you'd mind being yourself.
Yes, he's there.
Oh, all right, I'm sorry. Okay. You be yourself.
All right. Well, first of all, there's a slight confession, which is a funny thing happened on the way to the AA, which is that my laptop was stolen in Rotterdam yesterday, along with it tonight's lecture.
Jeff is not in the frame
now,
here.
Funny thing is, you would think that was a Dutch conspiracy, but in fact, Jeff arrived in Rotterdam exactly as it was being stolen at 3 o'clock from the doodah. So, you know, I don't want to, you know, it's just circumstantial evidence. But I don't, you know, so it's a very costly version of the dog ate my homework. But maybe we can use sort of that sort of technical failure as a chance for institutional invention, I guess, because I think one thing is maybe how to involve more of the audience than Charles, which was the other moment on Monday. So a little more participation, given the low resolution of the presentation, in a kind of classic McLuhan-esque fashion. I guess the other thing is that I was thinking that this is the vice presidential debate, but you know, I mean, the format of the debate really is really an invention of Peter and oppositions. I mean, I think he's the one who's debated everybody in the field, and so I think that also accounts for the misdirection of the event, which is Peter's comfortable in the format of negotiated debate structure. And I think, you know, and frankly that comes out of a certain tradition. We were talking about this with the MA and PhD students with Mark earlier today, which is the way in which the writing and the sensibility disciplines the way in which the work manifests itself. And I guess I wanted to start off by saying, you know, on the one hand, not wanting to be a stand-in for either figure, but also I'm going to give a little bit of a boring history, even without images, so doubly boring. And then maybe with the point of getting to the issue of what do we do after they're gone, because they're gone. which is to say, what is the legacy and what's the project after those figures, in the same way that they had to ask what's their project after previous figures that were difficult to deal with. So that's sort of the trajectory. But I guess I wanted to relate it to a little bit to this, the sort of the disciplinary context, which is to say that maybe Brett also, I think, showed a series of very provocative juxtapositions. And the other one, I guess, that he could have shown also is Tarani at Como. So, I mean, clearly we know Peter's connection to that. In other words, it's a window detail. The way in which that movement completes an ideal geometry. breathtaking hundreds of pages of analysis to get to demonstrate the sort of completion and incompletion of a kind of ideal geometric project, which is read through these sort of breathtakingly attention requiring axonometrics. But Rem equally could have used an image from Como, the same project, but just sort of the crowd of people in front. And I think that somehow that differentiation really, our architecture as that sort of mathematical problem, let's say, versus, let's say, as a statistical problem, is maybe one of those lines of differentiation. And so Jeff was mentioning earlier the kind of institutional formation of understanding Peter's project as a deviation from a longstanding problem at the University of Texas via Colin Rowe and others, whereas Rem's formation clearly here at the AA under the sort of guidance not only of Price, but also of kind of Foucault in the background, as someone being discussed by his cohort, let's say, of Bernard and Elia and Robin Evans and other people. So I think that's, I want to get to these issues of, what makes something a critical practice, and the issue of the subject and sort of the diagram and representation. So maybe my version is what I wish they had said or what I am glad they left for us to say. But I think that the first question of how do you establish a discipline, because I think Peter is very self-conscious about it, because in fact all the work is about a certain degree of self-consciousness. I think for Rem, there's a kind of classic, a different form of misdirection, which is to say, I know that, but I'm not going to tell you about it. And in fact, it wouldn't be possible without it, but you can go fail on your own, because I've got this other set of books that actually I don't expose. Whereas I think Peter is all about exposure and confession. But this issue of the disciplinarity, I think that for me, it relates, and I won't belabor this more than it needs to be, but I do think for me, one moment is the simultaneous sort of discovery of the frame in the mid-70s that both of them make. And so in 1976, basically, Peter is rewriting Corbusier's Maison Domino, and at the same moment, Rem is discovering the kind of American frame in Manhattan. And both of them, to me, are direct and explicit responses to 20 years earlier, when Colin Rowe puts forward the Chicago frame, or the Chicago frame essay, where he argues for the speculative intellectual project of Europe, that use of the frame, versus the banal speculator, economically, programmatically driven use of the frame in Chicago. In other words, Rowe wants to say, modern architecture in Chicago is not really architecture because it's not really disciplined. And his project is, how do I discipline modern architecture? The way Rowe disciplines modern architecture is to give it back to history. In other words, the first thing is to domesticate by classicizing the modern. And that means the frame structure has to be an analogy for the column and classicism. And so the first thing Rowe does is say that this diagram, the domino diagram, is not about construction systems, but it's really about a kind of rhetoric. It's the way in which a building establishes proportion and scale and rhetoric, and that it stands in for the column as being the icon or symbol of architecture for the modern in the way that the column did for the classical. So besides the sort of America versus Europe problem. So the first thing that for Rowe, disciplinarity is about continuity. The modern, if it's a modern architecture, it's not really different then, or it's comparable to the classical or what came before. Certainly the difference that both Eisenman and Koolhaas make is that actually disciplinarity is established by breaks, not by continuities. Whether you call the break modernism or metropolitanism or urbanization or globalism, that basically what's significant for the discipline is it's constituted out of breaks and not out of continuities. So Peter's version is, sorry, Colin, you got it all wrong. Yeah, the domino is interesting. Yeah, you're right, it's not about construction systems. Yes, I'm interested in an intellectual project, but it's not a symbol or an icon, as Peter himself would say. It's an index. In other words, what's important about the Chicago frame, about the domino, is precisely that it's a self-conscious system, it's a notational system, and what it's notating is the design process itself. Therefore, it's the first, he wants to rescue it as the first modernist, disciplinary, self-conscious artifact, and not as being continuous with the classical history. But in many regards, it's very sympathetic to Rowe's project, and with this big caveat, which is that it's clearly about the birth of a modernist project. For Peter, a modernist project means self-reflective, self-conscious, autonomous. In other words, architecture about architecture. The reason I'm not going to go into details because it's very clear how that operates. I think what's breathtaking about Peter's analysis is that he actually redraws that dumb sketch as a series of a lot of different axonometrics and things that Korb didn't do, but he could have done, but he didn't. In other words, maybe this is the kind of elaboration or mannerism or complication that is dear to Peter's heart in terms of setting up the kind of virtual processes that went into the sort of decision making such that we end up with that sketch, as if there's a whole series of yellow trace that basically Peter uncovered saying, oh, you know, Korb didn't get it right these times, but then he got this one right. And he does that basically to say that it really is a self-conscious artifact and notational of its own design process. Part of that seriality of the drawing, reproducing this sketch as a series of axonometrics in terms of the seriality is more or less turning architecture into this autonomous, lifelike process of self-transformation where the object, in a sense, is designing itself. Clear history, in a way, and therefore architecture as a kind of index. The Koolhaas break is basically to say, you know, the problem with you, Peter, and you, Colin, is that, you know, you celebrate the European over the American, but frankly, as a European, I can tell you, the American is more interesting. And in fact, it's going to be a similar diagram from the early part of the century, but it's going to be this cartoon from Life magazine from the same vintage as Korb that's going to show even better the problem of modernization or metropolitan lifestyle that's really what's at stake. And so I think that this is also the first moment of grafting the project of modernism not to the project of autonomy, but to the mass cultural. And not to the problem of animating a kind of life across the analysis, but basically to the production of the lifestyle, which is clear. In other words, what's important for the project is this new form of subject, namely the metropolitan bachelors that are, in this case, the cartoon of that, which is the production of, let's say, the virtual plots that are stacked upon one another. So, in other words, whereas for Peter, the frame structure, the grid, was a way in which to index the process of design, for Rem, it's really a way in which you can establish most expediently a kind of series of experimentations with different lifestyles simultaneously imposed on one another. And I think that, you know, more or less from that point on, you could take the trajectory of both projects and both legacies from those two discoveries and chart out the last 30 years as kind of, additions to that, let's say, those two twin possibilities, which is why I think they're significant, not for what they do even, but for what they enable in the field. So clearly, I think the other two projects that Brett showed are evidence of that. I mean, the two IIT projects, Peter's and Rem's, I mean, again, what strikes me most interesting about those projects is that both are very attentive to the context that it's a Mies campus, that in fact they're really responding to Mies. But there's not a kind of obedient version of repeating Mies, but actually two radically different forms of how you would reread Mies today. And Peter, of course, takes it through the ideality and reality of the grid, and Koolhaas takes it through the question of the metropolitan or the urban. I guess the caveat I wanted to put in to show how do you establish a disciplinary project is that neither really go back to Mies. I mean, of course, Mies is there, but they have to go through some other mediating figure, and that in that case, it's Robert Venturi. In other words, that the two possibilities of the IIT schemes are exactly the two avenues that are foreclosed by Venturi. In other words, what Peter does. In other words, the two avenues, the accusation of Venturi against Mies and against modernism is twofold. Either it's producing buildings as sculpture, namely ducts, or it's producing buildings as cities, namely the megastructure. And for that, those are the two avenues that Venturi seems foreclosed, which are the two trajectories that precisely Eisenman and Koolhaas re-inhabit as Miesian repetitions, but only because of Venturi's identification of that closure. So that in a sense, Peter substitutes the idea of landscape as sculpture, which is, you can also then see in his Berlin Memorial, which I want to get to in a second. So in a sense, the Berlin Memorial Project, which he did begin with, is a kind of variation of the kind of grounded landscape of IIT. And Rem takes building out of it and says, okay, it's not landscape, but it's the interior, and it's the interior as city that in fact is the new avenue. And I would say that that's another way to think of Seattle, which is the first project that was also shown in some by Peter, which is to say that they continue the IIT experiments in these other two more recent popular instantiations, but that the grids manifest themselves in a very different way. Either the grid is a device for notation and a kind of geometric regulation of the project, and a kind of critical exposure of what exists and doesn't exist in Mies, or the grid is merely an expedient device to organize people and activities in a particular configuration, i.e. what I would call the production of lifestyle. It's why I would want to maintain to some degree this differentiation between what I consider a critical project and a projective one. But maybe that will be elaborated a little bit later. In other words, clearly what Peter's project is, despite his animosity to Rowe, is also to sort of say that there's a huge history in architecture of this geometric protocol, and I'm going to elaborate its unconscious. For Koolhaas, it's an urban and metropolitan project, and therefore the idea of the interior as a form of city becomes a different vector of the problem, and clearly then its associations with other, no longer the skyscraper perhaps as its model, but the shopping mall as its model for a student center. In other words, it starts to graft itself to other peripheral typologies within architecture, or on the fringe of. I think that this issue of like what is the subject that the two end up producing is, let's say, one of the ways in which I think you can start to differentiate the critical from the projective ambitions of the projects. That Berlin, let's say, is all about, it's largely, in other words, I think there are people who would criticize Peter for not imagining any subject for his work, in other words, but in fact, there's a very specific kind of subject that he imagines for his work. And in other words, it's a critique of the humanist subject, and it's going to be produced through a kind of estrangement and alienation, and it usually works one-on-one, i.e. he imagines a single individual who is going to see the project. So in a certain way, somewhat parodically, when Rem shows a kind of picture of Peter lost in his own monument, that's one version of it. I mean, a kind of self-estrangement, maybe, because not many people can fit in there. So it's sort of a one-man operation. Maybe some cameras coming over the sides of the slabs. But I think the idea that basically it's about dismantling, even though he's interested in seemingly in passivity now, a kind of passive, distracted viewer in terms of a kind of alienation and estrangement found to displace that form of subjectivity. I think that Rem's form of subject is always a collective subject, and therefore it's about multiple, a kind of a multiple or a pack subject, a collective subject, which is why I think that the Tirani image of the crowds is really would be the motivator as opposed to the window shift. But I think, the other, and this will drive, because I hate to say it as well, but it will drive Jeff crazy, but the other, I don't want to talk about the spectacle, but
I am going to anyway,
not because I care about it, but because I think that Peter is now, in a sense, there's a whole field of architects out there now who are wondering, how do I actually communicate with the public? Certainly Alejandro is, it's the new issue for architecture of either a critical or projective ambition is, how do we communicate? And I think for Peter the issue is this issue of the spectacle, but the spectacle always as a lure or a tease to criticality. In other words, get them in the seats and then alienate them.
You saw it.
This is what I borrow from someone else as calling the wow, huh, project. Which is to say that you first seduce them and then you hit them over the head.
Suspect take.
Yeah. The other version of that is the huh, wow. And that, I think, is the Seattle model, which is to say something that's initially off-putting, but that afterwards you basically just say, you know what, that's pretty amazing, and I want to be a member of that group that likes that. I do think that this issue, you know, Peter was saying that Rem's project is an icon. I couldn't disagree more. I understand what he means, but basically I do think it produces a kind of logo, and I would say a logo is different than an icon, and that, in fact, that this, that one of its tricks, or let's say one of its capacities, is to produce a new form of collective that didn't know it existed before. I think that there are other people operating today who often also have offices in this city, but who have institutional affiliations elsewhere. How much more detailed should I be?
Can they talk?
Big wave. Who are also interested, I would say, in a compensatory form of the icon. In other words, to reproduce what already exists in a community as its own self-image of itself and give it back to them. I don't find that a particularly persuasive form of communication, which is conciliatory and more or less reproduces an image of a collective that it already imagines for itself. So
the last clue is hokusai.
That might just be wow wow. as opposed to huh, wow, or wow, huh.
That's crying all the way to the bank, I think.
Yeah, so it really is wow, wow. And hunka, hunka. In any case, I think that sort of there's a side issue of sort of this, who is the subject, which is that it is an individual subject of estrangement, even if it's packaged in the wrapper of spectacle. So it's also how Peter really wants to differentiate himself from Gary, because let's face it, that's how he's trying to map himself into a territory. And Peter's world is constructed by Rem in Europe and Frank in LA, and he's in between. It's like too hot and too cold, the three bears, basically. And he needs to have a little more than the West Coast and a little more than Europe. Which is to say that I think that this issue for me of notation is really Peter's contribution, and maybe also starts to form a bit, let's say, of a dead end at a different scale. In other words, I think that you can make the case for the way in which in the early houses the project that he takes from Korb's, the transformation of the domino, in terms of all we have are slabs, columns, and openings, and stairs. And these are the elements that we have to make architecture from. And then I'm going to simply do another series of transformations that Korb could have done if we were alive today. But I'm going to continue that project. In fact, it's obviously a project that he's fabricated, but nonetheless produces a genealogy for. But at the scale of making the columns notational, either real columns, fake columns, walls, slit windows that are vertical and horizontal, more or less the same as the columns that have been displaced. It more or less works at the house scale. I think by the time you get to Spain, that project of notation is no longer legible with the means of its expression. So basically you have to revert to huge areas of, this is my second joke for Jeff, huge areas of poche, but also facade treatments, soffits, kind of barnacles on the side that register the grid at a certain scale, because the actual systems of the architecture are of such a scale that that project is no longer legible without notation starting to veer very closely back into ornament. And I think that it becomes a kind of test that, in fact, that notational project out of Domino starts, it's necessary for Peter's criticality. That's what differentiates him from Frank, and the grid and geometric manipulation produce that form of disciplining that he doesn't see in other work that he would consider gestural or expressionist. I think that, so for me, the legacies of these two figures, which I guess is the last thing that I want to get to, is precisely how you overcome the modern I think I was inspired in this insight by listening to Jeff at the Bear Log yesterday. He has a much different and more subtle version of this, which has to do with disestablishing the ground. I want to talk about the surface, not, which I think is actually in some ways more convincing than the story I'm going to tell. But the story I want to tell is about the issue of architectural articulation, let's say the vertical surface and not the horizontal one. So that if one were to say that what modernism displaces from the classical is the question of ornament, to repress it and to reinvest it in articulation, i.e. detailing. In other words, we don't have ornament, but we have detailing. In other words, the systems themselves will produce the effects that we need. Clearly that wasn't enough for Rowe, and Rowe in some sense wants to revert back to facades. In other words, the problem with modernism is that it became an elevation and it was simply about the articulation of building systems, and it really needs to be more dialectical, thicker. Even though we don't need Pochet, we have to conceptually reproduce Pochet, and we do that through shallow space or his version of transparency. Different story, not necessary to know, but just to say that Rowe is the first who has a problem with articulation. Peter takes that project toward notation. In other words, I'm going to overcome the problem of articulation through notation. Although I would say, again, in the more recent, bigger scale projects, it starts to verve dangerously back to the question of ornament. I think that for the Koolhaas version is to say, get rid of the detail altogether. Basically, get rid of the wrapper, if that's possible, altogether. The problem wasn't the elevation that we need to revert to a facade, but in fact, what we would hope for is a pure section that, in fact, doesn't even need an elevation. In other words, the wrapper itself becomes irrelevant in the early projects. I think that those are two versions of how to rethink the problem of articulation today. The other ones that I think that are, let's say, the next generation, I think that largely the contribution of the non-standard or the mass customization or the investment in new material systems or assemblies or construction systems, what Greg Lynn would call intricacy, is one response to the problem. In other words, a differential relationship of part to whole, but it's still, I mean, it's funny in the sense that it is both notational and tectonic at the same time. It's sort of, imagine the kind of unseemly marriage of Ken Frampton and Peter. In some sense, that becomes the, what I would call the project of intricacy. I think there's a different way to go, and I think that last night Jeff called it, my version of it was the topological problem, which I think is still also privileges a certain idea of ornament. I think the other way to go is the graphic strategy, which I think Jeff last night was associating with the kind of single surface projects in some way. And for me, that graphic project is comes out a little bit of the idea of appliqué as opposed to ornament. There's a debate, let's say, between that form of graphic projection, which I suppose, to be more polemical about, is more of the, if we're supposed to choose sides, more of the side that I am interested in pursuing. But let's say that there's a range of practices that have tried to deal with this problem. And so I think that Jeff last night showed the blebs of Greg on the one side and maybe some of MVRDV's work on the other. You could obviously differentiate the embryological house as the manipulation of the intricate assembly of parts to produce the figuration or the ornamentation versus something, the other slide that Jeff showed last night, which was the Hagen Island project of MVRDV, the sort of what he describes as the monopoly houses, treated in a kind of monochrome materiality. I think that those two housing projects, if you will, start to sort of speak to the issue of the differentiated legacy. And which I think is an interesting advance and is also our problem today in a way. I guess the very last thing I want to say is the issue of research, because in some sense this issue of pedagogy or research today, because where I think the followers, I think where the absent figures are, were actually in some sense more cunning, is that their followers take the message too seriously. In other words, they believe the myth of research. I think that research was always a bit of a con or a conceit for Peter and Rem. I think it was a necessary conceit, but I think everyone schooled in those methods actually believes it. And I think that in some sense, the problem today, whether one investigates the sort of the technological geometric problem or whether one investigates the sort of social statistical datascape problem, that basically the idea of architecture as a science to me is what needs to be overthrown and what actually the promoter is really never, they may say they believe their own press, but I don't really believe they do. But I do think that there's another generation that has taken on the problem of research as a kind of fake scientism, and that's really what needs to be displaced in favor of really the, what I would consider a political register as opposed to a kind of science truth register. But that's more about the kind of open-ended debate part. So that's the official comments, if that's about the right time.
Great.
Okay, we'll go straight on to Jeff.
I was just saying that the other day. That's what the uncanny thing is. I just said the exact same thing the other day.
You sure you don't have my laptop?
the contextualization of the argument that that I would but it's different from Bob's, and I'd like to make it. The issue for me is, what is a critical practice, and why does a critical practice arise, and is its project finished? Not was it wrong, but is it finished? And if it's finished, is there another project, critical practice, that replaces it, or is the legacy of the critical practice for the moment complete simply because it's all of its possibilities either have been confirmed or its claims to cliches have been shown not to be confirmed? The background for this is the first generation of projected practices was modernism, meaning modernism imagined a new and better future and imagined it could instantiate it through a materialization of a new world in architecture. So projected practices, I think, are really important, but they came with a real bad legacy, in the sense that all the promises they made about their projective powers produced frustration and failed realizations. And so you have Peter and you have a whole generation, and remember that Peter's the generation before Rem, and they're looking at this issue of, okay, there's something wrong with the world, or there's something we want to do for the world or with the world, but we can't make a better world. We can't imagine a better world, and we can't make a better world because those guys just really screwed up the world badly doing that. And even if we really believe we could have done a better job than that, and what they just didn't know what they were doing, we can't go public with that. And so instead of that, they develop an idea of a critical practice. Now, in the basics, a basic way for me to think of the critical practice is to think of the careful examination of the body of received practices to see which of any of them have become empty cliches. That's what I think. That's a general framework. It means I take a look at something that continues to operate, and I examine whether our relationship to its persistency is still a vital persistency. Does it still work? Does it still serve us? Or has it become a cliche? Has it become an institutionalized form that we stay obedient to, but that has no longer any efficacy in our lives? And if you can slowly, tactically, uncouple the practice from its accruals of cliches, then you will have, in some sense, liberated it and enabled it to be mobile again and responsive to culture. Now, so there's the problem of the critical practice in relationship to the projective practice that I think is a good place to start. The second one is this thing I'm going to read you by Bataille. 90% of the people in this room have read this or heard this so many times it's going to drive you crazy. The other 10% are going to find this so boring it's unbelievable that anybody would talk about it. But it is what they were interested in. But before I get to that, I do want to say something really important, and that is Bob and I teach at the same school, and the tuition there is incredibly cheap, and we're real close to New York, and we're real close to Los Angeles, so I think you should really consider... Sorry.
And it's in Ohio.
Which means good morning in Japanese. I found out today from my cab driver, however, that OMA, OMA, means grandma. And that every time they get the call, they thought they were being told, who knew this? And they're going to grandma's house, you know, go to Oma, you know. That's really funny. And Ram, of course, was irritated that I mentioned it. So this is the quote from Bataille. In fact, it is only the ideal soul of society, that which has authority to command and prohibit, that is expressed in architectural compositions, properly speaking. These great monuments are erected like dikes, opposing the logic and majesty of authority against all disturbing elements. It is in the form of the cathedral, or the palace, the church, or state speaks to the multitudes and imposes silence upon them. It is in fact obvious that monuments inspire social prudence and often even real fear. The taking of the Bastille is symbolic of the state of things. It is hard to explain this crowd movement other than by the animosity of the people against the monuments that are their real master. Now, remember, so this is the context. This is the context of a kind of philosophical thinking that's rebelling against not only the history of monumentality and the history of architecture's association with power, but the appropriation of modernist promises about rethinking that relationship and its appropriation by power. And so, it's set out, what I think is incredibly interesting about it is, unlike most writing by philosopher, it doesn't confuse building and architecture. It's a statement about architecture. It's not a statement about dwelling. It's not a statement about the house or the building as such. It's a statement about the power that is installed in social life through architecture as an expert practice. And so critical practices, it lays out three possibilities, but at the time we only understood two possibilities. When it starts to talk about the monument and how it speaks, it's talking about the semiotics of the monument. And so one critical project is to turn your attention to the way semiotics produces meaning and obedience and regulation, and to see if a kind of hereticism of semiotics can be examined and deployed. And that's what Peter does. And so he turns his attention not to remember the language model of Venturi was about reestablishing the commonality in the communication, reconnecting architecture as a device of communication with a population which no longer communicated to. Peter did something smarter or more interesting. He changed the stakes from speech and language to writing. And at that point, writing becomes a practice of discussing structural semiotics and its production of, let's say, regulatory meanings beneath that are insidious in relationship to issues like signs and symbols. The other thing the statement says is that it operates in terms of church, state. It lays out institutional structures of authority that are collaborated not by the semiotics of the form, but by the collaboration of the building with the institutional program that it occupies. That's where the AA and the Rem in particular saw their possible critical practices, and that is to see if the relationship between an institution and the way it organizes its power through the operations of architecture can be undermined by rethinking the status of the institution. For me, I think the third possibility in there that we are now looking at today is in the end. Because when he says, when the people attack the Bastille, that is the proof of the problem of architecture, you begin to realize that when the ideality of an institution and its production of meaning becomes specific in terms of a location and materiality, it becomes vulnerable. Because the Bastille can be torn down, it's where architecture actually renders power structures and semiotics available to sedition. And so for me, the possibility of a critical understanding of material, an approach to construction of materiality that's no longer grounded in a phenomenology, no longer grounded in pre-critical or historical persistencies, is now becoming available to us. So on the one hand, that's the context, and that's the way I think the three, that's the way projects can be seen. I see a lot of the work that's done, let's say, by Jacques Herzog and Nouvelle in terms of the latter project. And so I see that as also as a critical project, but with a different kind of undermining of cliches. So That said, I think it's worthwhile to, I mean, in the diagrams I showed last night, the discussion last night was really to pick one possible place of the many that are possible where each of these two architects have started to work and show that they are exactly after the same problem from two points of view, the institutional point of view and the formal point of view. And not only that, they go back and forth in their explorations about to what extent they're going to engage that problem. The problem I talked about, and Bob mentioned it, is the disestablishment of the ground in the following sense. Architecture's, the ground becomes political as soon as it becomes land. And land and ground are different things. Land is the politicization and the control of property. And the land and land law continues to regulate property, continues to regulate political space with an incredible power, and it's probably the last legacy of feudal organization and feudal control. The only insight capitalism had about land and ground in relationship to feudal practices is to change the... Please don't tell the truth about this later on, because I know you actually know the real history about this, but this is just me pretending like there's not anyone that knows any better. Feudal practices understood land to be available to being private property. It was exactly the same thing as property you can own. Don't shake your head yet. Capitalism turned it into real property. And so real property law to changes from private property law, all you can do in capitalism is to control to a limited extent the operations on it, but you can't own it. You can't own it and anything that grows on it and all the people that are on it. So real property is a slight development in the deregulation of the feudal zoning of land. And so architecture has a particular interest in the ground. It either establishes the power of the authority in relationship to the ground, why you go up a staircase to get to a church, what doors are about, entries. You either do it semiotically, or you do it phenomenologically, or you do it in terms of the dramaturgy, let's say the institutional dramaturgy. If I walk into the Supreme Court and I'm about to be heard on a, let's say, a, you know, what do you call those, a capital case, and they're going to kill me. You know, if I've all, instead of walking past six layers of Corinthian columns, I walk past six layers of lava lamps, in the old Pee Wee Playhouse where they replace the Ionic columns. Yeah, I'm probably, even if they put me to death, it's not going to be such a big deal, right? It's going to be, wasn't that fun? And so how you disestablish the ground, I think, in other words, how does architecture make a contribution to the political discussion? And I only just picked this as one example. It was quick and easy example. And I distinguish between Korb's lifting the object all the way off the ground and reestablishing another ground on the top, as the beginning of formalism. If you take the object high enough on Piloti that it erases the ground, and then you reestablish the ground and you produce all the floors as equivalences, you have begun the process of imagining a democratic possibility no longer connected to the ground. The problem is the door, and I think I've mentioned this before in here. You can't solve the door problem. If you lift the building off just a little bit and you step off the ground onto the stage, then the dramaturgical problem. But it's not the stage that's going to change anything. It's the stage's relationship to the play. And I think that's how a good way for me to understand the operations of Rem Koolhaas. And so the difference between a stage plan and a free plan, and the difference between a platform and a form, I think are the way I look at their operations. However, if you imagine that all Rem ever does is work with institutional programming, and that all the operations of ornamentation, form, structure are irrelevant to him, but that it's the conceptual apparatus of the institution, you've missed the point completely. There's no way to be discriminate. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to show you a picture of Seattle. There it is. Detecting, and I'm not going to say another word until I'm just going to ask for a raise. I came here and I gave a lecture about the director search, which made it very clear that I was supposed to get the goddamn job. And how you gave it to Brent, I never... I'm sorry. I had to kill some time until the picture came up. Okay.
If he was quieter about the money.
If you look at this, and if I've asked you to pay attention to the relationship to the ground, if you are sensitive to, in other words, if things in architecture are exaggeratedly important to you, and you get ridiculously interested in little ridiculous things, then this building has a fantastically interesting mechanism for disestablishing the ground, and all of a sudden you can understand something you probably never noticed before. If you don't, if you're like my wife and all my friends and everybody else I know on earth that's not in this room, once you say it and you say, wait till I show you this, and then they say, you show it that and they say, what? So what? Who gives, you know, then you're like normal human beings. But that's going to be true for painters. When Mondrian hit Van Doesburg in the head with an iron for rotating a square into a rhombus and put him in the hospital, it was because he thought something was really important and it really mattered to him. And that's what's going on here. Now, what I ask you to pay attention to is the change in the surface ornamentation. I don't have a pointer, but it's right this second. First of all, it should be completely obvious to everybody, just what I've already said. Because if you look at the ground platform and you ask yourself, where is the ground of this building? The ground of this building is not the street it's sitting on. It's that little wedge that the building is sitting on as its tentative podium. The fact that the building on top is bigger than it at the bottom makes it provisional. And the fact that facade treatment completely changes the language and how you enter, that is the stakes of the outside of this building. There's nothing, this is a beginning analysis of it, but either that's incredibly interesting to you and incredibly powerful, or this building is what most people think it is, and that is a gimmick to attract attention to Seattle for 10 minutes in the news, which is, you know, okay. But for me, I find that little wedge really important. And what happens if you enter that door versus what happens if you enter the door on the other side, and why it's different. However, I cannot see that unless I've been trained to see that from a formal analysis. You know? So I know, and I know Rem knows it's there. I also know it's not important that he tells anybody because it's not about a constituency, it's about an audience. The library serves its political life by serving as a constituency. It's just like you go to a movie, you know, you're not, your constituency is a casual audience with no real interest in the particularities of it as a moment where all of a sudden the possibility of life is reconfigured by examination of a material practice. But for a small group of people, the audience for whom these are big effects, that's a big deal. And I think you'd be a fool not to understand that that requires a formal sensitivity. And I think if you don't see it right away, then there's something missing in your training. And I think that's what Peter is about. So in a certain sense, I'm representing Peter's argument here in order to make Rem's architecture available to you. And the whole discussion of this building, but what that also means is, you know, so in a certain sense, I think they share an argument, and I can go through a lot of projects and show, if we just looked at the history of their treatment of the ground through a while, you would start to see them going back and forth. When do you use formal devices? When do you use institutional devices? When do you use, for example, the Wexner Center, it's impossible to find how to get into it, and you never know when you're at the beginning of the museum. That's not actually a set of formal devices. That's a Rem Koolhaasian device for disestablishing the authority of the entry of an institution. So it's just like Rem. It's what Rem does a lot. But it has nothing. There's no way you can incorporate the entry procedures, the staircase, and where you enter into the galleries into your thinking about it from the procedures that he uses to, the formal procedures he uses to put the grid and the slice together. So what I thought I would do now for the fun of it is also mention, I got, you know, 5 more minutes, mention that this is 2005. It was 2005, it's 2006, but in 2005 was the centennial of the Einstein year. Y'all know this, right? And all the publications that were written by scientists, I found this incredibly uplifting, were about all the mistakes Einstein made, and about 2 out of 3 papers by Einstein being either wrong because he made high school math errors, or conceptually wrong because of deeper physics he didn't understand, or even fraudulent, where he knowingly published something that he already knew was wrong, because he had a kind of libidinal commitment to the work he had done. And so there was this exposure about the weaknesses of the process of doing the work, because all the papers are this. Once he made that fraudulent paper, or once he made that mistake, it went on to produce, because he stayed with the problem over years and years and years, it went on to produce the work that we now celebrate. So I thought I'd show you maybe the 2 weakest projects ever, the weakest project Rem Koolhaas ever did, and the weakest project Peter did. They're both about the ground, and they're both about taking a certain idea that they were working at a time and believing it too much. Maybe I'll just show you. Now, see, here's why I know there's something wrong, because if you don't break into laughing when you see 8 stories of Poche, you know, forget how weird it looks or wacky it looks, but if you, you know, this is what, you know, what Bernard was talking about. What Bob was talking about, and that is, you know, basically if the elevator disappears into dark space and never comes back out, that is one of the funniest jokes ever told in all of architecture. And, you know, but you got to be ready to see it and get it. this is a project, you all know this project? This is the Scientime at Gymnasium in 1993. There was a debate last year, night about the year. This is a project by Rem Koolhaas in earthquake-ridden Japan for a gymnasium, and it's incredibly interesting, because what it does is, I don't know if you can say it, it's a gigantic let's call it scaffolding system with gigantic counterweights on pulleys, so that the building can go, half the gymnasium can go up and down for different kinds of programmatic relationships. You know, so if you want to do a football game, half the building goes flat on these 100 million ton counterweights. If you want to do a Wizard of Oz celebration, you can tilt this thing that way with other counterweights and use that little staircase. And so the building is about doing 2 things, erasing the ground as best you can and doing something else that Rem had studied for years and years and years, and that is how to introduce mechanical devices, because the cliche he was interested in was the cliche of the destitution of mechanics in architecture. He still is. So the elevator, the sliding door, the air conditioning, his examination of the inability of architecture to contend with a technology that had entered the field and reconfigured its sociology and politics was a focus of research. And this was the most extreme moment. And it was, he decided to get rid of all of his relationship to history, all of his relationship to the canon, purify the work. It's the most generic project he ever did. It's the source of the chapter of generic architecture, but also it's the first time you see SML and XL ever appear anywhere in anything to do with Rem Koolhaas. This is the beginning of that book. Long before, this is where the title of the book came from. But it, and you know, so, and what, how does he draw? He doesn't know what to do. He doesn't know how to what to say. There's no program in it. There's none of that. All there is this gigantic, ridiculous building on counterweights in earthquake country moving up and down. This should give hope to all graduate students. I can remember how proud he was of this. I swear, he was coming through. It was amazing how proud he was of this. And, you know, he always shows it to you with this look on your face like, I can't wait to hear how great you think this is. Another tragedy. This is a more complicated tragedy, but this is a tragedy. Unfortunately, you can't see its real colors because the colors are incredibly tragic. See, there's a pink and green stuff. I mean, you have a very smart projector which takes care of painterly problems. But this is the Long Beach Museum project. This is the point where Peter's archaeological projects going into the ground and sort of revealing the ground as a new source of semiotics, which was a very interesting project, putting the Canareggio and several of the important. But at this point in time, he was desperate. The practice was about to fold. He needed a job. And he used every possible device he could use from that, essentially, to attract the interest of the developer. It's so in the those buildings in the back, which are totally generic, are here's where you put your museum, and everything else is about the wonderful history of San Jose or whatever, you know, the derricks, and you know, and so it turned it into a tourist attraction. Zero critical thinking about the ground, and basically, oh, they're going to love the derrick because they love the armory at the Western Center. They're going to love this curve. They're going to remind them of everything. They're going to love this. And then they'll go to the museum in the back, which has no qualities whatsoever. Both of these projects, and in fact, I learned this, and I'm indebted to José Ubery, who's Le Corbusier, living Le Corbusier, last of the living Le Corbusiers. He's in Wallpaper this month for the most anticipated construction project. You know, he's doing Fermini. He's absolutely fantastic, and he's a great architect in his right. And he teaches, by the way, at Ohio State University, where we all get together and talk like this all the time. And students sit around.
Because there's not a lot else to do.
And it's, you know, and basically everybody that comes to the place gets either a teaching job at the best places in the world or highly paid. Sometimes they're made the head of corporations. This is Strasbourg, as I was reminded last night. So if you'll notice the square and the vortex inside. I don't know if Peter mentioned this, but he has an analysis of REM, which is essentially the internalization of this diagram, taking the vortex and putting it back inside the box as basically the governing formalism of REM's work. And I don't know if he did it, but it's absolutely brilliant. And what would have been fun for y'all is have Peter come lecture about REM and then have REM come lecture about Peter. Then you would have found out what they might have said that neither Bob or I could have guessed what they would have said. This is the Corb. This is the section of the Canareggio Hospital. And I just want you to pay attention to the room and the roof, because as REM is trying to figure out how you do that, how you take that vortexical field and put it inside a square, he goes through a series of projects. This is Fukuoka. These things come right around the aftermath of the Saitama project. So this is the roofscape of Fukuoka housing, which is installed in that square. That square is a plastic imitation of the Emperor's Wall. This project, in all of its political ambitions, is entirely formal and entirely grounded in the canon of the discipline that you cannot possibly have any relationship to it unless you know it. It then becomes incredibly interesting. Other than that, it's a good movie or a bad movie. And here's the plan. And there's the sections. So you can begin to see how he's using that work. By the time he's beginning to develop an attitude about what it means to inflect this ground, and now he's starting to work on the ground. This is the Maison Domino diagram, now inflected, and now he's beginning to work in the institutional work. This is the library. And so the voyeuristic relationships, the changing of the ground, the change of the idea of imagining a new future as opposed to criticizing the way that the Maison Domino diagram staged a certain kind of social relationship. So by now, he's able to take both the history of the canon and the history of the formal language and shift it to its institutional critique, which is where we most admire him for. But it's only because he was working with that material. In Peter's analysis, this is the beginning of Strasbourg's internalization of the vortex. Peter, at the same time, at Long Beach, has now moved out of that problem, and he starts to produce these weak form works. And he starts to, this is the convention center, a competition he won because he had the best program. They voted on the three entries. The three entries were Michael Gray's, Wes Jones, and Peter Eisen. Wes Jones was there to win the project. It was a setup. He was supposed to win the project. John Berghee was the chairman of the jury. He was there to give Wes Jones the project. All Wes Jones had to do is show up and shut up. But instead, Wes was against his two teachers, Michael Graves and Peter Eisenman, and thought he needed to go all the way out. And so his project came in 80% over budget, and there was a 15% disqualification rule. He never made it to the jury because of the cost. So it got down to Peter versus Michael Graves, and everybody hated both of them. there was a public outcry. The three projects, if you'll forgive me, were called Vomit, Snot, and Shit, Vomit, and Snot. They're the three things that come out badly. But Peter won the competition because they had to give it to a prize, and he won it because his convention center consultant made the convincing argument that it was the only one that worked. And, you know, so there was a way he worked, at least, you know, so he's working on the ground, he's trying to develop the arguments about going back and rethinking the ground. He begins to go back to the resources that it was using for the first institutional histories, and then he starts to do these kind of projects. And if you don't think this is a critique of a church, of a critique of the institutional status of not just a formal analysis of Pochet and its relationship to the ground, but if you don't understand this as having an institutional impact on the liturgy of the church, then I think you miss the point of this project. The project is powerful because it's a church for the Vatican, not because it's a discussion of stealth-like forms that you read a kind of Pochet relationship of interstitiality. And that brings us to the two plates. So now I'm asking you, are you ready to understand this? What is the most important element of this work? For me, and I haven't given you enough argument, but let me do it as a teaser. This project has its most important innovative experiments in its use of the surfaces, and in particular, the pillowed surfaces at the top. Because when Bob mentions IIT and its relationship to Mies, he's dead on, because IIT, Mies has an equivalence of floor and ceiling to set up the space. IIT begins to fold the two together and then start to essentially produce an equal potentiality of materiality in that interstitial zone. It's all, so the exorbitant, exaggerated, hysterical use of surfaces begins at IIT, and it's about creating a different kind of equivalence between floor and ceiling, and basically erasing that stage or the proscenium of that stage to produce another kind of stage. And it's now taken to an exaggerated level here. And this project, once you see this drawing, and we've discussed the project, we understand this, if you have a critical, if you want to discuss what is your thinking about Peter's new work, you begin to realize that this is a big mistake. This is not a big mistake because it's gorgeous material. It's incredibly expensive. It's the first time he's ever been allowed to build with real materials and all that sort of stuff. But what it is a local quarried stone that's going to reestablish the status of the ground that the whole project is about disestablishing. And there's no grid up there. There's none of the critical. He just got seduced by the possibility, finally, of having real expensive materials, and having a bunch of critics who had attacked him for years of not paying attention to it, including me, answering to them, and it turned out we were wrong the whole time. That all of that dry vit and all of that drywall and all that dematerialized construction was only right way to do it. And so we screwed him up, he listened to us, and now he's putting the ground back after a project that I just got through showing you is about a humorous and institutional critique of the ground. So that's it.
Okay, we have some time. Do we have a microphone that we can use? Who would like to ask the first question?
Charles. You know, Zaha's going to suffer, though, because I write criticism. And the fact that she's not here tonight, that's going to show up in my discussion of her next work, believe me.
Is there Charles Jenks here at all?
No. Charles is never here, even when he's here.
Can anyone do Charles Jenks since we're using all these personae?
Nah, Charles is tough to do. The guys that could you really do good, that really had easy voices like John Adick and Aldo Rossi, they're all dead. And nobody can do Rem, because once you've done Rem, you've done Ben, you've done Winnie, you know, basically it's one sound, and so no one can ever tell. Sorry, if you're not going to ask questions, I'll tell jokes for a little while. There's one.
No, don't do that, only one else. Someone got the.
Either that or I can repeat it for you. He asks, what's the tuition in Columbus?
Yes. Last night, one of on some of, no, not last night. On,
yeah, I know. Rem's, seemed like forever ago.
On Rem's slides, there was one of the slides was about modernism and urbanism, and he never said anything in detail about it. And I just my question is, I mean, I don't know to both of you is, how do you think that? I mean, how can we overcome the problem of modernism, which is apparent in both of their work?
Jeff, can you repeat the question?
How can we overcome the problem of modernism, which is so obvious and obviously ruining Rem's work and so really great in Petersburg? Wasn't that the question? Sorry. How can we overcome? He sees the legacy of modernism in both bodies of work and urbanism. He didn't feel like they adequately discussed that issue. And you know, how do we proceed from the problems that not understanding the city and the destituting forces of modernism has plagued the life with through architecture? And you can learn to say that too if you study at the right place.
I think Jeff actually makes a case for why the way in which both practices, in his terms, reoriginate modernist diagrams, and so to that extent the project is maintained. I guess what I was trying to say is that, in fact, they have very different ideas of what modernism is for their own purposes, and that for Peter, it's a late formalist idea of modernism as the kind of self-referential project, and that's what allows him to gain running room from Rowe. And for Koolhaas, it's really imbricated with the mass cultural project. And so to that extent, I think, and Peter confessed in the night that he hasn't done urbanism, or that's the project he wants to do that he hasn't undertaken. I think,
oh God,
in Rem's case, yeah, save us, is that what you said? in Rem's case, I think that it's precisely that. The important, let's say, put it this way. For Peter, the important break was that architecture never did modernism, and therefore he was going to bring modernism to architecture, because even under the guise of modern architecture, it was never really modern. It was up to him to bring us to the promised land through self-notation. For Rem, the problem was always that architecture, in a certain sense, died after the metropolis or after the urban, and therefore a new form of architecture emerged, which in fact didn't exist before. So in fact, it's the pressures of the urban that actually produced a new, the end of a project and the beginning of a new project. But I mean, I think they both speak through breaks, but for Peter, the break is an aesthetic, but the belated elaboration of modernism in architecture, and for Rem, it was the fact that in fact the city produces a new broken condition that requires or enables another form of architecture.
I just would caution you that you should entertain a question like that for a little while you're young and then forget it. Because basically you need a polemic question like that to start a body, to energize a body of research. And I think both of them did that. There was a little while, and you don't remember, it used to be funny. Rem would lecture and Peter would lecture. The first sentence out of both of their mouth was, "For 400 years, architecture," and then they'd say two different things. One would say, wrote text about anthropocentrism, and now we can write different texts. And the other one would say, produced an argument about the processional from the ground to the piano nobile, and now the elevator erased that. But they would always start off with, "For 400 years, architecture did this one thing, and now it's time to do something else." And when you're young and stupid, and you do that, you get a really big project. Whether you're Johnny Flatten, whatever the guy's name was, or what was it, your guy Johnny Rotten, whatever it is, or if you're Stravinsky, or if you're Schoenberg, "I'm going to write the music of the future." The way to write the music of the future is to get rid of the tonal center. So you have this polemic conjecture. From that moment on, you give up all of that, because the problem of how you write music with no tonal center becomes an expert problem. You focus on it, and you no longer are considering its broad cultural journalistic arguments. You're simply going from the next step to the next step to the next step on that problem, and that's what's going to happen. So take this time to find some cause, associate the cause badly with some silly association with architecture that will never hold up to scrutiny, turn that into a problem, and then work on the problem. And that's what's going to happen to you. But it isn't, so I do want to encourage you briefly to think there's something wrong with modernism and there's something wrong with the city and I'm going to fix it. And then later on, when it turned out there was never anything wrong with modernism and there was never anything wrong with the city, but you now have a good practice and are teaching in important schools, everything will be okay.
Well, that's very helpful.
And we've offered...
absolutely.
Come on. I can make you ask questions. I have techniques you wouldn't believe. You want to see?
Yes, well, one of them is not being other people. is there another person who'd like to ask a question?
Go ahead. Well, let me ask you this. I know you don't have any questions, and it's okay, but if you had one, what would it be? You see, it works. I mean, I just use it as a, but, you know.
We're both concerned a little bit about this whole website thing, because when we hear
website,
we get
nervous. Yeah, what happened on the website thing?
So, we don't want to see this tomorrow, so tell us now.
I have some questions.
There we go.
You said before that Eisenman and Koolhaas, because I don't know them personally, as they're not friends,
Well, wait a week.
So, why are you here?
Why are we here?
Yeah.
We're critics.
I'm
not going to let Bob answer, but I refuse to be here when they're here because I have stuff to say about them that I have to say. I'm certainly not going to sit there and paraphrase them for you, whether they said it or not, because what I have to say about Rem and Peter has nothing to do with what they have to say about it any more than what we write today about Shakespeare has anything to do with what Shakespeare had to say about it. I know a lot more about their work from the point of view that I work on than they ever will. Now, why are you here, Bob?
Actually, there was a shop I wanted
to buy.
You thought
you were back in Ohio looking after the students.
Muji.
Yeah, I think it's really important. I mean, Rem and I were talking today at lunch, you know. And this is a field that I swear to God, if you're in it for a week and you don't know everybody on a first name basis, there's just something wrong with you because it's real small and everybody wants to be real famous. And so we have a contract with each other that we all learn each other and make each other famous by being famous to each other. So, and my wife is famous for saying, never have so many been so famous to so few. Now, but he said today, that he was concerned. What, Mark? You want me to
see? No.
That he was really concerned with the fact that a kind of intellectual laziness had set into the field. That the architect not only had to do the work, but had to describe the work and criticize the work for everyone else. That essentially, you know, the process in which a body of work comes out and other people comment on it and criticize it and discuss it and deepen the work, had essentially disappeared into the idea that the architect does all of that and maybe a critic paraphrases it or turns it into pedagogy. And I think that's a real loss. And if you imagine, for example, there's something, I read something like 2 million pages of discussion and criticism on the plays of Shakespeare. Generally, most people think Shakespeare was a fairly stupid person. I mean, basically, he certainly didn't know 2 million pages of intellectual life. At 29 years old, he didn't know Freud. He didn't know, you know, but because he was good at what he did, he was a close observer of life and knew how to turn that into funny plays. The plays ended up with a content well beyond. I know there's some Plato dialogue that Margot tells about, you know, and our job is to keep all that work contemporary. And, you know, criticism and discussion and discourse is an independent practice with no obligations to the source material and to repeating the source material. And I really encourage you to read it that way, practice it that way, engage in it with that way, and not basically ask every architect to spoon feed what they've done to you. Worst of all, let's say they do, like Peter, don't take that as the end of it. Yeah, because there's a lot of stuff going on in his work that's better than he thinks, and there's a lot of stuff that goes on in his work that's fairly obvious that is not as good as he thinks.
I'm just thinking, I marked this essay by a student who thought he was on a first name
with
basis Jeff. With architects. No, he thought the architect's name was Michael, and then he thought the surname was Angelo.
Hey, I got a worse story than that. I was desperate one day in the middle of writing an article, and I went to the library and I kept looking up Roe, R-O-H-E, because I thought the guy's name was Mies van der Rohe. You know, so I thought Roe was his last name. You know, and I never could find the guy.
I mean, he was a distant relative of Colin Rowe.
Well, I just, you know, who knew that there was Ludwig?
Another question?
Yeah, I don't have much fun. I remember now Europe not being much fun.
Yeah.
This is like, forget okay. It, Jake. It's only Chinatown. Linz was the last time, yeah. I think.
Graz.
I have a question for you. Are you depending on the forgotten legacy of projective architecture to start to disinter the idea? I mean, are you projecting tactically, or are you calling for a projective architecture strategically? Let's say modernism's mistake was a kind of naivete of strategic projection. When you talk about a projective architecture, what are you talking about? What would its terms and conditions be? Not what problems, not the graphic versus, but yeah. What's its goal?
I mean, I think that we talked a little bit about this earlier this afternoon, and I think that my argument was, yes, it is in part to recuperate the ambitions of modernism, but in fact that who's done that the best, if in an unlikely way, is the new urbanists. And so if I had to identify what's a projective practice today, I would begrudgingly say that the new urbanists are the only are the most evident form of a projective practice, and that's because the critical legacy that you've identified foreclosed certain, or that we've both identified, have actually shut down, as a critique of modernism, got rid of, you know, those techniques and devices that would be actually useful in instantiating alternative worlds. So I think it is part of the institutional project that I've seen in Koolhaas, but I think that the new urbanists have actually done a better job of producing the diagrams, codes, images of lifestyles that would be different than the normative, although admittedly fairly close in some ways, but still sort of offset from reality, and that their particular mixture of the classical and the vernacular is only one possible instantiation of a virtual world that isn't this world, and that therefore we should experiment with other forms of projecting alternatives, and my interest is in the mixture of modernism and mass culture as an alternative. But I think that basically the techniques that we gave up out of sophistication because they failed, and I think what you pointed out last night was that in fact modernism didn't fail, it just succeeded in another realm, i.e. the developer commercial realm, and so in fact it was never a failure except for architecture, but what we gave up was the part that seemed the architectural part, and the new urbanists inherited it, and it's about time to take it back as a kind of political gesture.
Maybe there's like an opposite question to pose to you, which is, I mean, especially thinking of the quotation you read from Bataille, I mean, it seems to me one of the problems for the history of architecture in its formulation of a political project is basically that political project, in one way or another, has always been mortgaged off to something like an image of socialism. I mean, or an image of some utopian kind of political goal. Now, one of the things which the Bataille quotation opens up, actually, is the possibility of having a strongly political architecture, which is not actually kind of utopian, because like Bataille, it works by selecting its enemies. I mean, in that sense, the question is, you know, and it sort of stems a bit from Bob's point. If you thought that the definition of the political was not about realizing at a physical level some image of utopia, but was in some sense about fighting. I mean, you sort of bear on it when you're talking about the political dimension of the disestablishment of the ground, where it becomes more of a kind of plebeian, but obviously it would have to be a new type of plebeian, kind of sedition, as you put it,
mm-hmm.
against, in a Bataille sense. You know, that wouldn't fall stricture, that wouldn't fall under the strictures of some of the critiques which have been made against architecture's kind of so-called political project, because it's not dependent on something else.
But that's still a project in resistance, right? You still, you know, the idea that you would, I mean, the reason I'm saying this, Bob, I keep imagining when I hear Bob, y'all know new urbanist projects, you know, and you know what they look like, and you know how good they are. In a certain, they look just like Leave It to Beaver, and when we grew up. But I now imagine a big tract of incredibly interesting Case 22 houses with lots of bars and swimming pools and a kind of, you know, I mean, there's a certain, I call it critical lounge. All I can think of is another rich community in a gated community with a different sensibility. And I think that's an interesting prospect, because all of a sudden the possibility of genres comes in. So I, instead of choosing between new urbanism and not, which is what our choice is now, new urbanism and the pursuit of singular practices, we can now choose between new urbanism or hip urbanism or country urbanism. In other words, we start to produce a set of lifestyles as a commodity by any kind of expert practice. I'm not so sure that's a bad idea. I think that's actually an interesting idea. But I also don't think that sidesteps the critical project, that sidesteps the political project. And it basically understands that you cannot do a kind of urbanism by constantly saying what not to do. Because one of the great things that the new urbanists did is said, didn't come in and say, don't put in grids, don't put in this, don't do, you know, which is how we do cities. Don't plan. Remember how important it was, that intellectual idea that don't plan. Even my favorite is architects that were proud because they couldn't predict the outcome of what was going to happen in their work. You know, I think this building is incredible because no one knows what's going to happen in it. And isn't that great? And I, you know, that. And you can't, how are you going to convince anybody, you know? You go to a dentist and he says, I'm going to put this tooth in and it's going to be fantastic. I have no idea what it's going to do. So I wondered, from Mark and Bob, is the realities of architecture's efficacy in social life, the degree to which it can help smaller groups of people find architectural expression rather than, in other words, instead of a constituency, which has always been the problem for theoretical architecture. I don't have an audience. I have a constituency. And I don't try to satisfy the needs of a particular audience. I work on the problem of a generic constituency, which basically always gets into trouble. If we realize we don't ever have constituencies, we have small communities of audiences, and that we should see that the field is already practicing like that and become more expert at serving local audiences. Is that sort of what?
Yeah.
Your argument is on. And so you basically, it's not about giving up the political project, it's just recognizing that's the only political project. Is that okay with y'all?
There's time for one more question before we finish.
Brett? See? I can, you know, when you're as old as I am and you've lost all the jobs you wanted to get and you've finished negotiating for the money, you probably can do any damn thing you want. Come on, one more question. Somebody ask Mark a question. Why do you think dark pink and light pink? Sorry.
Go on.
What does that represent?
It doesn't.
What do y'all think of Archaeology? Bob? Look at that.
Well,
thing.
Together we're actually Peter. We're Peter's
Bob,
project.
Isn't Bob dressed like?
I could do this and we'd end up being like
Bob
California.
Looks to me like, what's that guy that always was working in Las Vegas? Wayne Newton. Doesn't that kind of look like Wayne Newton? I'm sorry.
You don't see the details.
Incredible. Look at that.
Yeah.
So, you know, Paul Jones.
He does that intentionally, doesn't
Come
he?
Come on. One more question, we go home. There you go.
Given that Monday's Face-Off was such a resounding success, could you imagine another pair of living architects?
Uh-huh.
I think dead architects are easy to kind of fantasize.
Uh-huh.
Who you would like to kind of see in that sort of Face-Off situation?
Yeah.
In the sense that that pair was, I couldn't imagine.
Well, first of all, my challenge to you is, Never accept that something's basically you need to see Monday Night for the positive content it contained, and it contained a lot of it. Their job was not to entertain you. Their job was in some sense to consider their positions in that circumstance as honestly impossible. Therefore, it was filled with content. And if you fail to get it, that's your problem. That's not their problem. Now, if you want to know who would be really entertaining, you need those young kids that are still at their polemic state, that are ready to argue naively about the instrumental possibilities of their position, and watch that, because that's when that stuff was really great. They really get each other, they knock each other out. They're not protecting their social relationships or their personal positions, and it can be incredibly fun and energizing, but it's also a form of entertainment.
I think one thing...
Let go of the entertainment model, sorry.
Given the fact that we have this large archive of video, one possibility is not just having two people, but having someone answer themselves from 30 years before, which might be, quite kind of interesting. On the other hand, I was thinking on Monday, there's actually one that we better have very quickly, because otherwise it might not be possible. Both well into their mid-80s were here, Bob Maxwell and Alan Colquhoun. Alan Colquhoun says to me, "I don't think Bob Maxwell looks very well." Bob Maxwell says, "I don't think Alan's looking too good at all." So actually, we are going to try and organize this in next term.
What would be really fun for me is me being in the audience and you debating. And then listen to the questions I ask. I think that would be... Yeah, Alan, you remember that scene in Papillon? You remember this movie, Papillon? Where the guy sticks his head out and he's dying and he says, How do I look? And the other guy says, "Fine, you look great." And then they change places at the end of the movie. I kind of feel like that now. Sort of like I'm sticking my head out and saying, "How do I look?" Can I ask, now I need something from you because I just did some research I'm doing. How many of you play video games? How many of you regularly play video games? I'm just curious. So first of all, you already know that y'all are an incredibly out of touch, boring audience. Like every other architecture audience before you, you really have no idea what's going on, and you're one of the most uncool group of people in your zone. And that's why you're here. Because I was watching an argument on PBS the other night about the effect of video. It's 27 years old, every 27-year-old, they don't go to movies. They learn their lives through video games. I learned my life through television. People before me learned their life through movies, before that novels, before that drama. The same story gets told, so what changes is the medium. And when the medium changes and a whole of life changes, then you begin to understand that disciplinary practices is where the energy is. It's not the story, it's the disciplinary practice version of the story. And I think that's something you should understand that we're involved in.
So you see all these people playing video games in Ohio, and you say, "What are you doing?" "Oh, we're here to be interviewed by the MA."
But you staged a kind of wrestling match in Ohio, by the way, where people performed in a different idiom. It is younger, but doesn't. Scott, Wes. There would be people who would.
You have to have a strategy.
Expose their vulnerabilities in public, let's say.
Basically, I asked every child of Peter to come and defend themselves, and they got mad at each other for not being the favorite child of Peter. There are techniques. But, I think Bob and I have interesting debates. We're not doing it now so much, but it's clear we're close enough that small issues matter to us in a great way, and we spend a lot of energy discussing them. And, my favorite conference, just to answer your question, the best conference I've ever been at was a conference where a group of people were assembled. It was Ben, Bob, me, Jesse, Greg, Bruce Mao. This is 95. But instead of performing like a conference, what we did was we put ourselves in a room and let the audience sort of look down on the room like a surgical team. But we never could see the audience. We didn't present so much to an audience. We only talked to each other, and they only watched it as voyeurs. But because of that and because of the time it took, the discussion got very particular. You know, it was no longer about performing and entertaining, or it was about talking about subjects of interest. And also, everyone at the table was already so close that issues mattered. You hit each other in the head with the irons because you rotate an angle slightly, as opposed to, you know, having, you know, such diversity in the resources that there's no terms of engagement. But yeah, I definitely think there hasn't been that for 10 years here, and this would be a good place to, you know, try to do that.
Well, this evening's a start. Before we finish, I mean, I just want, on your behalf, to really thank Jeff and to thank Bob, and we expect you back soon.
I think it's a big advance on where you were. Personally, you know, the changing the discussion, for one thing, the movement of the problem is no longer art but science. That's really good. You know, but the shift in the projective, you know, the shift in discussing the techniques of the projective. In other words, it's not shape versus